Buddhu padu dullabhu 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 lokasmin manushya bhav dullabhu dullabhu dullabham saddham savana dullabha saddha sampatti tadvachita bhav dullabhu.
From time immemorial, the world has witnessed many Buddhas, the perfectly enlightened ones. Every Buddha rediscovers and teaches Dhamma, the law of nature. The truth that gives deliverance from suffering. Noble teachings of a Buddha benefit millions. Yet, after a Buddha departs, the teachings start to get converted into traditions, literature, and slowly the core gets lost in the flow of time. What gets left behind is the empty shells of mere words. Many eons ago, blessed by one such Buddha, Dipankar, a hermit named Sumedh took a vow to make all the necessary preparations to become a Buddha. Existence after existence, the Bodhisattva Sumedh accumulated mental energies and purity of the highest order till he took birth as Siddhartha Gautama in 624 BC. After ardent efforts of 6 years, at the age of 35, Siddhartha Gautama attained supreme enlightenment on the eve of the full moon day of Vaishakha. Having attained Buddhahood, Gautama the Buddha traveled throughout northern India to compassionately teach people to walk on the path of Dhamma. He exhorted his fully liberated disciples to spread it across India. Over 2 centuries after the Buddha, Emperor Ashoka was horrified by the bloodshed and sorrow of the Kalinga War that he had waged. Once introduced to Vipassana, he solemnly resolved to follow the path of Dhamma. The fierce Ashoka was transformed into Dhamma Ashoka. He facilitated the journey of fully liberated monks to 9 different regions of the world to make Dhamma available to all mankind. Post Ashoka, the practice and theory of Vipassana, the core of Buddha's teaching, started to deteriorate gradually, and over the centuries, it was totally lost in India, to the extent that even the word Vipassana went out of circulation. With the passage of time, most other countries too lost the technique of Vipassana. The world was plunged into the darkness of ignorance. In the midst of this darkness, only one country preserved this technique in its pristine purity, Myanmar.
Keval ye desh स्वर्ण भूमि है, सोना है, वो रत्न को संभाल के रखेगा, 2500 वर्ष तक संभाल के रखेगा, और फिर भविष्यवाणी की कि 2500 वर्ष के बाद जब भारत में इसका नामो निशान नहीं होगा तब ये बर्मा से भारत आएगा. भारत में अनेक लोग इसे स्वीकार करेंगे और तब ये विश्व में फैलेगा.
इन म्यांमार Vipassana was kept in its pure form by a lineage of dedicated monks for several generations till today. One such teacher in this chain was Lady Sayalu, a visionary monk who thoughtfully and boldly opened the doors of Vipassana technique to lay people.
Lady Sayalu was a big scholar. He was a master of Pali language. He wrote many books, many commentaries, many poems. He was a good poet, and then he became master of both. theory and practice, pariyati and patipatti. He realized that now 2500 years is coming. The Dhamma has to spread round the world, and it will spread round the world if the householders take up this vision. Because people will have more confidence in them, one thing, and people will feel more non-sectarian in taking Dhamma from them. And people will feel that this path is not merely for monks. So then he was the first person who decided that there must be householder teachers. And he gave teaching to a few householders.
Sayathetji was one of the early lay students. Born in a poor family in 1873, he lost his father at the age of 10. He braved abject poverty with hard work, great integrity and spiritual strength, and went on to become a well-regarded, prosperous member of the community. The untimely death of his children and relatives in a cholera epidemic prompted his fervent search for deathlessness. It brought him to Lady Sayadaw, who taught him Vipassana. In due course of time, Lady Sayadaw appointed him as the first lay teacher of Vipassana, recognizing his exceptional qualities and abundant paramis.
Initially, difficulty was there. First, he gathered a few of his own laborers in the farm and told them that what daily wages you get, I'll give you your daily wages. And they meditated, they got result, and the word started spreading. Well, there is something with this cultivator. People got attracted, more and more people started coming, and this is how it spread.
With the support of his wife and other relatives to look after his material needs, Sayathetji had ample time to introduce Dhamma to hundreds of householders and monks. This was a major milestone in the modern journey of Dhamma. One of his most promising students was U Ba Khin, a senior government official renowned for his integrity and efficiency. In 1941, Sayagyi U Ba Khin met Venerable Vibhu Sayadaw, a monk who dwelt in seclusion and was believed to be an enlightened arhat. Seeing Sayagyi U Ba Khin's astonishing progress in Vipassana, Vibhu Sayadaw advised him to immediately start teaching. Obeying him on that very day, he taught Anapan meditation to a station master at the nearby Chowski railway station in a railway carriage. In 1952, Sayagyi founded International Meditation Center at Yangon, where he taught Vipassana to thousands of Burmese and foreign students. Sayagyi U Ba Khin had immense love and gratitude towards India. In one corner of his center, there was a model of the lofty peaks of Himalayas. He would meditate beside it every day, sending his goodwill to India and wishing for Dhamma to return to its land of origin.
उनके मन में इस बात की बहुत धर्म कामना कि किस तरह से भारत का हम पर ऋण है. भारत ने इतनी बड़ी संपदा, धर्म की संपदा हमें दी, इतना अनमोल रत्न हमें दिया. आज भारत कंगाल है, उसके पास नहीं है. ये विद्या नष्ट हो गई, बुद्ध की शिक्षा नष्ट हो गई. हमको ये कर्जा चुकाना है. एक ही बात बार बार कहते थे, हमें भारत का कर्जा चुकाना है. ये अनमोल रत्न जो भारत से आया, वो भारत में वापस जाए. द्वितीय बुद्ध शासन जागेगा, दूसरी बार बुद्ध का धर्म जोरों से जागेगा, ऐसी मान्यता है. तो इन थोड़े से आचार्यों ने ये विपश्यना की शिक्षा लुप्त ना हो जाए, भारत में लुप्त हो गई, बाकी देशों में लुप्त हो गई, हमारे यहां लुप्त ना हो जाए, इसलिए संभाल कर रखी कि 2500 वर्ष के बाद ये विद्या भारत जानी है, बुद्ध की शिक्षा सारी भारत जानी है. तो हम उसको शुद्ध नहीं रखेंगे तो जाएगी कैसे, और जाएगी तो शुद्ध रूप में कैसे जाएगी. आओ संभाल के रखा.
दिस डॉक्यूमेंट्री कैप्चर्स द जर्नी ऑफ प्योर धम्मा, द मोस्ट प्रेशियस जेम फॉर मैनकाइंड. From one small country that preserved it carefully to the rest of the world, it is a story of its renewed availability and spread. The rise of Dhamma.
Ekayanu vayam bhikkhave maggu sattanam visuddhiya shoka paridevanam samatikkamaya dukkha do manassanam atthangamaya nyayassa adhigamaya nibbanassa satchikiriyaya yadidam chattaru satipatthanati.
The earnest wish of Sayagyi U Ba Khin bore fruit when an exemplary instrument of Dhamma, S. N. Goenka, was born in 1924 in Mandalay, Myanmar. Goenkaji's life was full of twists and turns, it would appear Dhamma had planned. He was deeply influenced by his pious and poetic grandfather, who instilled devotion, fondness for poetry, and love for the motherland in Goenkaji. Though born in a staunch Hindu family, he grew fond of silent contemplation with his grandfather in Mandalay's famous Mahamyamuni Pagoda, kindling in him a spiritual quest at a young age.
Guruji vipashta karne ke pehle to bahut Krishna bhakt the aur Babulal aur dono bhai itne bhajan gaya karte the bahut bhajan gaya karte the.
Rahiman Sudha, a book gifted by his school teacher Dubey ji, inspired him to write his first Doha at the tender age of 8 years. Dedicated to his grandfather, these first Dohas were the beginning of the hundreds of inspiring couplets that he wrote in Hindi and Rajasthani languages throughout his life.
Itna padhne ka shauk tha to bachpan mein jaise unke lekh wagaira mein bhi honge bahut jagah ki school ki time par kaise kitne lekh likhe kitne parvachan us waqt hi dene lag gaye chote mein. उनका एक रूम पूरा इतनी बड़ी लाइब्रेरी थी पूरी लाइब्रेरी से भरी पड़ी थी इतनी स्टडी करते थे.
As Goenka ji grew older, his leadership qualities, generosity, and commitment to social reforms became evident. In spite of securing a gold medal in matriculation and keenness to get to a college, he dutifully obeyed his family and entered business, soon impressing all with his extraordinary flair for it. Undaunted by the disturbance and exile caused by the Japanese attack on Myanmar, Goenka ji continued to excel in business. On the sidelines, he showed unwavering commitment to social causes and was chosen a leader of the Indian community and several other organizations. However, wealth and prominence brought along the experience of the first noble truth, dukkha.
As I grew, at a very young age, I was successful in business, successful in society. So, a lot of tension because of ego. Well, I am now such a successful person. And the migraine started coming with more frequency. Every 15 days, there's the attack. And very severe attack.
In 1954, while serving as a member of the food committee in the 6th Dhamma Sangayana, Goenka ji indirectly came in contact with Dhamma. A year later, a suggestion by his close friend that Vipassana could be a cure for his migraine, a psychosomatic disorder, brought Goenka ji to Sayagyi U Ba Khin.
So I went to my teacher, Sayagyi U Ba Khin, discussed with him, and I told him I have come because U Chantun has sent me to you to get rid of migraine. He said, no, I won't take you. Go to some doctor. This is not the hospital. And then very compassionately he explains to me that you are devaluing Dhamma. Look, the Dhamma is to make you liberated from all sorts of misery, not just this migraine. Coming out of migraine is a very small thing for the technique for which you will be taught. This is a byproduct only. once you get this technique properly practiced, migraine will go away. But don't come with the aim of curing your migraine. I said, all right, I won't come for migraine. Forget migraine. But if you can give me a technique which will purify my mind, certainly I will come. And I went there.
Goenkaji attended his first Vipassana course between September 1 and 11, 1955 at the International Meditation Center and underwent a life-changing transformation. He almost abandoned the course on the very first day but progressed so dramatically thereafter that Sayagyi had to take his special care.
Course was at International Meditation by the time the center was established, and there was one room or two rooms with attached bathroom, proper rooms, but my Sayagyi gave me a room. It was just four pieces of plywood, no window, the one door was only this plywood, and hardly 5 feet. When I sleep, I cannot spread my leg properly, and in front of it a row of latrines. I thought, well, there is a good room there, it is vacant, some important VIPs might be coming, that's why Guruji is not giving me that place all night. One day, 2 days, nobody is coming, 3 days, nobody is coming. I stay there. Later on, he told me, I want to crush your ego, so I gave you that. You are a leader of the Indian community here, you are a leader of the business people. You have got so much of ego in your mind, you must work there. And if you can work there, you will be successful. And I was successful. So that was the first course at the International Meditation Center that I got.
For the next 10 years, Goenkaji regularly meditated and served at the IMC. In 1964, due to the nationalization of private business in Myanmar, he suffered huge losses. Ignoring the seemingly material misfortune, he immersed himself in the study of the teachings of the Enlightened One under the guidance of his teacher. With this combination of pariyatti and patipatti, theory and practice, Goenkaji achieved profound understanding of Dhamma. Unknown to Goenkaji, Sayagyi was training him to fulfill his destiny of being a torchbearer of Dhamma, to spread Vipassana first in India and then all around the world.
My first training was to give Anapana and to give Vipassana. Then suddenly Sayagyi says that, Goenka, why we give courses only here in Rangoon? I would like to give course in up country somewhere. Can you arrange? Yes, sir, we can arrange. So a course was given in Myanmar. Evening discourse, Sayagyi makes me, there's a cot there, sleeping cot, and that becomes our Dhamma seat. Sayagyi sitting and I am myself sitting. In the evening, Sayagyi said, now you give the Dhamma talk. You can speak, all right, you speak. After 10, 15 minutes again, he will prompt me. Now Vishakha, and I have to speak something about Vishakha. Now Anathpindak, I have to speak something. 1 day, 2 days, 3 days, and then it went. He was planning that I have to take gypsy camps in future. So I must be well trained for gypsy camps, not just giving courses in the center. So one in Mandalay, one in Memeo. So that was a good preparation he made for me. And then of course, when I came there, I remember, oh, that is why Sayagyi took me to all these places, to train me to give gypsy camps.
As the time ripened, an opportunity presented itself, and Goenkaji got a visa to travel to India to teach Vipassana to his ailing mother. On June 20, 1969, Sayagyi formally authorized Goenkaji to teach Vipassana on his behalf. Before they parted, Sayagyi assured him, "You are not the one going, I am going. Dhamma is going." The prophecy, based on which this liberating technique of Vipassana was preserved with great care for 2,500 years, was about to come true. Once again, the Ganges of pure Dhamma was ready to flow throughout the world for the benefit of many, for the welfare of many. June 22, 1969, Goenkaji landed in Kolkata, India, and that very day, tremors were experienced in eastern India. As predicted by Sayagyi, nature expressed his joy on the return of Vipassana to the land of his birth after a gap of nearly 2 millennia. Symbolized by the moment Goenkaji put his foot down at the Kolkata airport. In spite of these early signals and the assurance of his teacher, Goenkaji's mind had lurking doubts.
तो जब आया तो पहली कठिनाई तो ये हुई कि कौन मेरा साथ देगा? ये तो गृहस्थ है, धोती कुर्ता पहनने वाला, ये क्या देगा हमें? कौन है हमारे पास? और वो भी आए 10 दिन के लिए, 10 दिन के लिए घरवार छोड़कर हमारे पास कौन रहेगा? और रहे भी तो कौन व्यवस्था करेगा? कहाँ 10 दिन का हम शिविर लगाएंगे? हमारे मन में आया कि यह भविष्यवाणी फालतू है, कभी होने वाली है। 15 दिन नहीं बीते कि वैष्णव का शिविर लग गया। कोई आगे खड़ा हो गया व्यवस्था करने के लिए, सारा प्रबंध करने के लिए। अरे विश्वास नहीं होता था, आ गया। फिर उसमें हमारी माता बैठी, हमारे पिता बैठे, बड़ा मन प्रसन्न हुआ।
Between July 3 to 13, 1969, the first Vipassana course was completed in Panchayati Wadi, Mumbai, nearly 2 millennia after the last course in India. Soon after, the second course was organized in Madras. Slowly, the word started to spread. The students who benefited from these initial courses enthusiastically came forward to arrange more courses. The wheel of Dhamma had started to rotate. After every course, Goenkaji used to send a report to his teacher, seeking his guidance. Sayagyi U Ba Khin used to feel a lot of satisfaction at his students' achievements. Sayagyi U Ba Khin passed away on January 19, 1971. It was while conducting a course in Bodh Gaya that the news of his demise reached Goenkaji. After deep contemplation, Goenkaji decided to drop all other worldly responsibilities and to fully devote the rest of his life to fulfill the most cherished wish of his Dhamma father. Goenkaji shared this thought with his family and received their wholehearted support and an assurance to take care of his needs. In September 1971, his wife, Ilaichi Devi Goenka, also joined him from Myanmar. Her quiet presence by Goenkaji's side encouraged a greater number of ladies to join courses. Goenkaji started to conduct the courses through the length and breadth of India. These initial courses at rented sites, at schools, temples, guest houses, hotels and mosques, they were full of hardships and trials.
Yeah, our first course, I registered, filled out the application form, and they said, okay, this is your room. Somebody took me up and showed me, and it was a room about half the size of this room, just a floor like this, a stone floor, no mattresses, no pillows, and in the hall it was the same, no sitting cushions. So whatever you had with you, that was what you slept on, that was what you sat on. And there was one water tap, one shower, and one toilet for about 30 or 40 women. So you get up in the morning, 4 o'clock, and you get on one line for the toilet, and then you get on another line for the shower. It was really rough, but nobody seemed to mind in those days.
So we were meditating in a tent on top of the building, and they'd set a tent up there. And so all of a sudden, this tremendous storm came. And it was a cloth tent, you know, they use for weddings and that type of thing. Wind started blowing, and it was really blowing. It was really raining. And the guys are all holding on to the ropes on the corner of the tent. And the wind's blowing the tent up. And they're pulling it down. And they're pulling it up. They're pulling it down. And it was so crazy. I mean, it finally got so heavy from the rain because it didn't have any weatherproofing on it, like canvas did, you know. And it just collapsed, and everybody's stuff was underneath, and oh my gosh, you know.
The tent was gone, but here's Goenkaji at 6 a.m. chanting on the Dhamma seat with Mataji. So that was very inspiring to see that the Dhamma wasn't going to get blown away, that you could remove the tent, but Goenkaji was still there and he wasn't going to stop teaching. So they scrambled and put the tent back up, and we continued on.
प्रतापगढ़ वहाँ देखा कि उन्होंने बनाया आश्रम मगर वो कच्चा था एकदम छत जो था ना पक्का पूरे सूखा भी नहीं था ऐसे लकड़ी जोड़ के उसके ऊपर ईंटा रख के ऐसे करके बनाया था नहीं देखा धम्मा हॉल मुझे तो डर से लगा फिर मैंने गुरु जी को जाके कहा गुरु जी वो धम्मा हॉल तो मुझे ठीक नहीं लग रहा है तो आप जाके देख ले तो अच्छा हुआ उन्होंने देखा बोला नहीं होगा खेत में मट्टी वट्टी तोड़ के खेत जमीन था उसका वहाँ पर बनाया धम्मा हॉल गुरु जी के लिए एक तो बक्सा बक्से में कपड़ा बिछा के ऐसा करके गुरु जी उसमें बैठे तो इस तरह वो कोर्स पूरा हुआ
The course was held in a building site, a multi-story building site in Calcutta, where it was an incomplete high-rise building with the concrete floors and the some of the walls and just covered in concrete dust. And the people there had just finished, were just finishing sitting 10 days with Goenkaji, and the people we were meeting, who were old students, came out covered in concrete dust on day 10, having just had metta. And the food was sort of in some sort of open area on the ground floor, and it was quite incredible. Yes.
शुरू शुरू में उन्होंने इतना कष्ट भोगा उन्होंने कुछ रहने का ठिकाना नहीं बाथरूम का नहीं फिर भी वो अदम्य उत्साह से काम करते थे जैसे बद्रेसर का शिविर हुआ और पहले दिन हमने ये ख्याल नहीं किया उनको जो कमरा दिया था और उतरने के लिए पगती नहीं थी तो हमने पत्थर रखे थे जिस पर गुरु जी पैर रखकर नीचे उतरे ग्राउंड पर तो वो पत्थर ऐसा हो गया और गुरु जी को फ्रैक्चर हो गया पहले ही दिन ऐसा हुआ हम लोग तो घबराए अभी बुलाए इनको पत्थर अभी फ्रैक्चर हो गया है अभी आनापान कैसे देंगे और मुंह कैसे बताएंगे पर गुरुजी के मुंह पर जरा सा भी वो नहीं वो तो बिल्कुल आए लकड़ी में लेकर पहले इनको ले जाने वाले थे वो प्लास्टर के लिए पर उसके पहले मैं इनको आनापान दे दूँ तो उस पीड़ा में वो लकड़ी लेकर लंगड़ाते लंगड़ाते आए हॉल में आए और एकदम हाँ 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 हा करके हंसने लगे और हम लोगों को पीड़ा में आनापान लेकर घुस गए और प्लास्टर लगा गया
उस जमाने ग्रीन कलर के बिस्तर टाइप के आते थे एक तरफ में तकिया और एक तरफ में कम्बल और नीचे पतला सा बिस्तर लगा के लपेट के उसको बेंटा बोलते थे वो बंद करके वो ट्रेन में घूमते रहते थे जब माता जी नहीं आई तब तक थर्ड क्लास में ट्रेवलिंग करते थे पूरा मतलब आप सोचिए दो बरस तक थर्ड क्लास में ट्रेवलिंग किया
भजन के रास्ते चले गए उनको तो सब चीज से जूझना पड़ेगा उसको तो शराब शराब सब आएगा एक तरफ कुछ तकलीफ आ रही है एक तरफ अपने आप से शांति होता था दोनों बात चली गई सहने की भी ताकत मिलती थी
The absence of proper screening of students meant that the organizers were unprepared for emotional outbursts of the students by the surgical cleansing of the mind induced by Dhamma. Yet, with profound metta and deep equanimity, Goenkaji used to face these challenges successfully.
Ningarki. वो मुस्लिम मस्जिद किसी भी थी एक हमारा रिश्तेदार कोई आया था वो नागों की तपस्या करता था कुछ भी उस जमीन में बैठा
ऐसा वो नाग बन के आया कितना दूर से चल के ऐसे नाग अपना सिर को फन मारता है ऐसे पांव करते जाने अभी क्या करेगा ये ऐसा सिर्फ जमीन को मारता करता फिर वो मस्जिद के ऊपर चढ़ गया कभी कुछ किया कभी कुछ किया और पत्थर उठाएगा तुम लोग को मारूंगा ये करूंगा वो करूंगा
गुरु जी बिल्कुल वहाँ से बस मैत्री करते थे घबराते नहीं थे नीचे आएगा इतना बड़ा पत्थर उठाकर उनको गुरु जी के ऊपर मैं तुम्हारे ऊपर पत्थर डालकर अभी कुचल रहा मारने वाला हूँ और गुरु जी एकदम निर्भय तो उसका पत्थर ऐसे गिर जाता
I was sitting two or three rows back on the aisle and I was meditating with eyes closed, listening to the discourse and gradually became aware of some vibrations in the ground behind me and the feel of footsteps and I saw that a male student was marching down the aisle, waving his arms and shouting. He started to shout. He was shouting to Goenka, you're talking about suffering. Look at all these people suffering because of you. and he carried on and on and he went right. He approached the Dharma seat very closely and the course managers leapt up, tried to do something, but no, he wouldn't stop. And Goenkaji and Mataji just smiled benevolently and Goenkaji indicated for him just to sit down. No, he wouldn't stop. Eventually, he turned around, walked out. The story doesn't end there. Because during this course, a Dharma colleague of ours was recording the discourses. He found that he could splice the tape at the point where this tirade began and at the point where it left, and he joined the tape together, and Goenkaji's discourses rolled on without any, completely imperceptible break. So Goenkaji, after all that upheaval and commotion had just carried on the discourse and
उस समय उपद्रव बहुत होते हर एक शिविर में कोई धुनने वाला कोई चिल्लाने वाला ऐसा रहता था तो बाद में हमने गुरु जी को पूछा जब गुरु जी पहले ऐसा क्यों होता था अब क्यों नहीं होता है गुरु जी ने कहा जब मैं इस देश में आया ना शुद्ध धर्म का तरंग नहीं था जहाँ देखो वहाँ अशुद्ध तरंग थे और ऐसे मेली विद्या लेकर लोग आते थे तो गुरु जी आपको कितना स्ट्रेंथ पड़ा होगा अरे मुझे स्ट्रेंथ तो ठीक मेरा गुरु उ बा खिन वहाँ बैठा था ना वो मुझे सहायता करता
Goenka ji was visionary in allowing flexibility in the code of conduct in the initial years to accommodate the conditions of those times.
Second day, fourth day, or sixth day, Montakali.
Silent days meant no talking, but writing notes was okay, gestures was okay. So we were fully communicating, we just weren't talking.
Us courses mein सेग्रीगेशन का भी इतना नहीं था जितना अब है मतलब महिला पुरुष एक दूसरे को मिल सकते थे
तो उस वक्त 80 रुपए 10 दिन के कोर्स का भोजन का चार्ज होता था सिखाने का चार्ज नहीं था
All of a sudden I see one man walking from room to room outside it was in at the Burmese Vihar And I said, what is he doing? I asked them. They said, oh, he doesn't have the 30 rupees. So he's asking for money to be able to pay the course. And then I heard that next courses, they had changed the system. And instead of having people walk and ask for donations, in the table where you make the, where you inscribe yourself for the course and where you pay the money, for the course, they had a bowl with money. And all you needed to do is just take money from the bowl and finish paying. I went there to pay, and all of a sudden I see Guruji's name, who also paid 30 rupees, as if he, who being the teacher, was paying his part.
Due to the lack of proper facilities to implement the code of conduct fully, Goenka ji was lenient with the students.
And we used to walk down to the gate and get buy chiki at the gate.
And peanuts.
And peanuts. Maybe it sent somebody down to get gulab jamun at the market. One time I came back, I was walking back to my room and Goenka ji was walking down on his morning walk with Judla. And I had my head down in the bag behind my back. I was feeling very guilty. And Judla looked at me and said, any question? And I went, no. Just walked on.
So I come back into my room, it's like 9:30, 9:45 at night, and I see these young Hindi guys getting dressed. New clean kurta. And I said, where are you going? He goes, we're going to cinema.
Hamare ghar se 10-15 jane shaam ko aa jaate the milne ke liye aur khana wana lekar ke puri picnic jaise hote the.
Well, it was one of the wilder courses that probably ever happened in the history of Goenka's teachings, I'm sure, because I mean there were a lot of crazy things in those days, because there was a wedding. This woman from California. And anyway, they decided to get married. And they got married. And all of the women on the course, all the Indian women, they got this beautiful sari for her, and they dressed her all up. The Indian men, they got him all dressed up, and he had a turban and this fancy white pajama pants, and then there was a couple of the other students that were taking the course. They also were all dressed up, and they, in the middle of the course, like on day five or six, they all went out to this Hindu temple.
But Guruji was so relaxed. You know, he had all these, you know, hippie-type Westerners. Yet, you know, it was just all part of, you know, oh, they shouldn't be doing that, or they shouldn't be doing that, and, you know, it was such a relaxed atmosphere. And he was just walking around at times.
After a course, I remember in the middle of, I guess, a long course that I was sitting, I all of a sudden started remembering all of these things that we used to do, and I was mortified. I was just so embarrassed, and I went running to Goenka ji, and I said, I'm really sorry, Goenka ji, I'm really, really sorry that we were just so bad. And he just laughed. He said, look, if I was as strict with you then as I am now, you wouldn't be here.
In spite of disturbances, the results were stunning. More and more new students were joining the courses, and many old students were repeating the courses, providing conducive atmosphere for meditating to the new students. In addition to the direct benefits received from the practice of Vipassana, Goenka ji's exemplary conduct and magnetic personality became a lure for them.
तो हिल पे चढ़ रहे थे मेरे पास एक प्लास्टिक का थैला था जिसमें मेरा एक शर्ट और पजामा था तो ऊपर चढ़ रहे हैं पैदल ही चढ़ रहे हैं तो गुरुजी का अरुण तुम्हारी तबीयत ठीक नहीं है तो थैला मेरे को दे बाद में समझ में आया कि ये हर एक को गुरुजी उसी तरह से व्यवहार उनका रहा हमेशा
I was asked to meet him at the train station in Patanka. He was coming up to Dalhousie, so I go down to the taxi the night before and just waiting for his train. The train comes. He wants his tickets going back to Bombay. So he wouldn't have to deal with this later on. So he tells Mataji and I to just wait in the cab, and he went and stood in line for an hour at the Patanko train station, trying to get tickets. He couldn't get them. He said he came back smiling. He said, "Never mind."
Ahmedabad mein shivir laga Guruji ka 1972 mein, jabki meri umar thi 11 saal, lagbhag 150 ke kareeb sadhak the, aur teen char aise the meri umar ke, aur Guruji humko bulate the kabhi kabhi. वो हमको स्टोरी भी सुनाते थे गुरुजी खुद स्टोरी सुनाते थे और वो शिविर जब पूरा हुआ तो मुझे बिल्कुल ही मतलब घर जाने को मन नहीं हो रहा था ऐसा ही लग रहा था कि ये शिविर और लंबा चले
Well, Goenkaji wasn't a guru who had a group of students around him, and wherever he went, he would arrive just as the course started, and then he would just disappear at the end of the course. And he would travel, he was alone, or maybe traveling with Yadav, or later on with Mataji, but he never had a cadre of students following him around. So he was very detached, always. When he was on the Dhamma seat, and if you had questions and were wanted to learn Dhamma, he had unlimited amount of time for you, but he had no time for gossip.
He was a man of principles. Principles ko kabhi compromise nahi kiya. Auditorium mein pravachan chal raha tha. Then a message was sent by the chief minister ki he would like to meet Guruji. अगर वो रेजिडेंस पे आ सकें तो गुरुजी ने कहा भाई धर्म गुरु राजा के घर पे नहीं जाता है तो मैंने कहा फिर क्या उपाय हो उन्होंने कहा थर्ड प्लेस पे ऑर्गेनाइज कर सकते हो
हाँ अजमेर में एक अजमेर निवासी व्यक्ति गुरुजी से पत्राचार किया कि हमारे यहाँ भी एक शिविर लगना चाहिए अजमेर जिले के एक तीर्थ स्थल पुष्कर में एक धर्मशाला खोजी लेकिन शिविर में बैठने वाला अजमेर का एक भी साधक नहीं मिला हम लोग जब यात्रा के लिए निकले हमारे सामने की सीट पर एक सन्यासी बैठे थे स्वामी अखंडानंद उनका नाम क्या आप कोई साधना वधना करते हैं क्या तो गुरुजी ने कहा हाँ मैं साधना करता हूँ और साधना सिखाता भी हूँ कल से पुष्कर में एक शिविर लग रहा है आप चलना चाहो तो मेरे साथ चलो शिविर अच्छा हुआ व्यवस्थापक जो थे वो स्वयं केवल 7 ही दिन ठहरे उनको कोई मीटिंग के लिए जाना था और रह गए सिर्फ सन्यासी मैं और गुरुजी 3 आदमी
दैट इज गुरुजी
9 आदमी की शिविर थी तो 9 आदमी की शिविर ले हुए गुरुजी ऐसा कि 100 चाहिए कि 200 चाहिए कि 5 नहीं जितना है इतना बैठो मेरे पास है वो मैं आपको भी दूंगा जो बड़ा गुरु होता है इतना सिंपल होता है मैंने तो किधर नहीं देखा आई हैव नॉट सीन
गोयंका जी वाज टायरलेसली सोइंग द सीड्स ऑफ धम्मा एंड दे वर बेयरिंग एम्पल फ्रूट्स टू सप्लीमेंट गोयंका जीज एफर्ट्स ओल्ड स्टूडेंट स्टार्टेड द पब्लिकेशन ऑफ विपश्यना पत्रिका अ मंथली न्यूज़लेटर इन हिंदी इन 1971 एंड International Vipassana Newsletter in 1974 to connect the students across the globe. The courses were evolving and students were getting more ardent about the practice, thus providing ideal conditions for serious meditation and spread of Dhamma.
Bhagwan batate aao bhikshu aur bhikshu ho jate the. Phir Bhagwan ne 220 भिक्षु के नियम बनाए धीरे धीरे जैसे जरूरत पड़ी वैसे तो यहाँ जैसे जैसे धर्म एस्टैब्लिश होता गया वैसे वैसे गुरुजी ने थोड़े थोड़े नियम जैसे माउंट का नियम पहले नहीं था फिर माउंट का नियम स्ट्रिक्ट कर दिया गया सिंगल एकोमोडेशन का प्रेफरेंस दिया फिर मेल फीमेल का सेग्रीगेशन तो पहले से ही था तो अभी बहुत टाइट बना दिया तो इसी प्रकार का धीरे धीरे करके मॉडल और मॉडल सेंटर कैसे होना चाहिए ये निर्माण हुआ
Slowly, the stream of pure Dhamma swelled into a mighty river. From 1969 to 1975, 122 Vipassana courses were held across 11 Indian states and 37 towns and cities. Dhamma's flow was now unstoppable.
It is true that when I came here, besides my family member, I made a list whom I know here to send them information that I am here now, I am going to give a course. The number did not reach 100. It was just 2-figure number. And now, as I keep on saying, mere to do haath, dharam ke hazaron haath. I got only 2 hands. Dhamma has got thousands of hands. All these thousands of hands, they are working. It spreads. Yahi pasiko, when somebody tastes this, naturally starts helping others.
Sayagyi U Ba Khin had foreseen the need of a permanent dwelling of Dhamma much earlier. The time to find that place had ripened. Land near Igatpuri was finalized. The priceless jewel of Dhamma found a casket, Dhammagiri.
Not that we chose Igatpuri. Igatpuri chose us. I remember after giving my first course in Bombay, I went to Madras, so I went through Nagpur. Train stops before the station due to some reason for 10-15 minutes, and it was the month of July or so, and this big waterfalls here. I was so fascinated. Oh, if a center comes in a place like this, ah, wonderful. After 1 year, it so happened that in month of June or July, I came here for a course, and I see the same waterfall. Oh, this place I have seen. Oh, this was the place chosen.
At the time of its acquisition in January 1974, Dhammagiri consisted merely of 3 or 4 old bungalows. A lot of efforts were needed to make the place inhabitable. To do that, in addition to the physical effort, Goenkaji's message to those early Dhamma servers was very simple. Meditate, meditate, meditate.
काफी वेस्टर्नर्स कुछ आ गए, वो आकर के वहाँ रहने लगे, तो उन्होंने एक और अच्छी बात क्या की कि एक जना वहाँ पर 10 दिन का स्वयं शिविर करे, रिले में 10 दिन का शिविर हो गए, मैंने डे वन से वहाँ ध्यान शुरू हो गया।
The first official course of 4 days was arranged for old students in May 1975. This was attended by 76 students in very basic accommodation. Soon thereafter, a 10-day course was organized, beginning October 27, 1976, attended by 89 students. After that, regular courses started at Dhammagiri. Today, this center serves up to 700 students in a course. As Dhammagiri was getting established in Maharashtra, 2 more centers, Dhammakhet in Hyderabad in 1976 and Dhammathali in Jaipur in 1977 came up.
जो Dhammathali में जो main involved थे वो राम सिंह जी थे. उनकी effort की वजह से this land was allotted पहाड़ियों के बीच में. It was a forest land. Pehla course tha, it was in jungle, sare tents mein tha. Even the Dhamma hall was in a tent. Kitchen, everything was in a tent. Aur us waqt jo elite of the city tha, wo bhi usme baitha hua tha. With all that, no facilities, nothing. Even no fence in summer. Everybody didn't mind all that thing.
मेरे ससुर रतिलाल भाई मंजी भाई मेहता ने देखा कि ये तो बहुत ही ऊंची साधना है, तो उन्होंने कहा गुरुजी को, आप हैदराबाद में जो हमारी ज़मीन है उसमें से हम थोड़ी सी आपको लैंड है डोनेट करना चाहते हैं, वहाँ पे आप आश्रम बांधिए.
तो जी गुरुजी का पहला शिविर जब हैदराबाद में लगा तो श्री रतिलाल मेहता की फैक्ट्री में लगवाया.
वहाँ पे उन्होंने एक अपने लिए कुटिया बनाई थी और साधना के लिए वो वहाँ पे चले जाते थे. तभी गुरुजी ने कहा, देखो बूढ़े बाबा, आपको ये कुटिया का बहुत मोह है, आप अगर इसको छोड़ेंगे तो ही मैं आऊँगा. तो उन्होंने कहा कि ठीक है भाई, आप वो बोलो तो मैं ये भी छोड़ दूँ.
The start of the new centers also enabled a stricter code of conduct. Noble silence was implemented fully. Goenkaji took great care that no creature would be killed or ordered to be killed in Dhamma land. Most importantly, the courses were running entirely on the voluntary donations of old students.
It was pinching to me that I take charges from the students, and there was no other way.
And it is to keep the technique pure. By taking donation from our students, we are obliging them. When a student gives, he gives out of a volition that Dhamma should spread. And with that volition, he can't come and boss. He will be very happy to come and serve only. So the tradition is maintained in its pristine purity just because the donation is received as symbol of gratitude from the student to the tradition of Dhamma.
Goenkaji insisted that the highest principles were followed in the organization and administration of these centers.
In 76, when Dhammagiri started, the construction of his room had taken place along with the other necessary units, and there wasn't enough money to pay the contractor. So Goenkaji didn't use his own residence because it hadn't been paid for. He was living in the back of D dormitory with no toilet and an outside urinal for him. Now, one morning, I happened to be down at the men's toilet at about, for some reason, I was down there about 3:30. And here's Guruji standing outside the western toilet. There was one western toilet down there on the men's side. And I'm thinking, what's Guruji doing down here so early, right? I go about my business. Next thing you know, Mataji comes out of the toilet. He was guarding the door for her. They didn't have a toilet in their room. They were using the only western toilet on the compound down there in the men's toilet block.
Or phir request kiya ki aap bolo to hum thoda paisa ikattha kare. हम कर सकते हैं आप हम जल्द बोला कभी बोलना मत पैसा इकट्ठा करने का जो बोलेगा तो धर्म खोएगा फिर तेरे को धर्म नहीं मिलेगा जिधर पैसा आता है उधर पैसे का वर्चस्व रहता है जो ज़्यादा पैसा लाता है उसके तरफ गुरु की नज़र अच्छी जाती है नहीं लाते बिल्कुल भूल जाना जैसा तुम्हेरे में धर्म बढ़ेगा हमेरे में धर्म बढ़ेगा पैसा आते ही जाएगा अपने को लेने को नहीं जाना पड़ेगा और देख इधर तो जंगल था इतना सब हो गया मांगे बिना किसने दिया तब हुआ ना नहीं तो कैसा होता है तो कभी नहीं मांगना भूल चूक से कभी भी धर्म के लिए पैसा मांगने को मत जाना
तो डोनेशन आए वो उसी चीज़ में जिसके लिए आया उसी पर यूज़ होना चाहिए या फिर वो एक्सेस है तो दूसरा एक्सपेंशन वगैरह में कहीं भी यूज़ हो उसका मिसयूज नहीं होना चाहिए वो ऐसे नहीं है कि ट्रस्ट का काम है तो रुपये की जगह सवा रुपया लगा दो कोई चेकिंग नहीं करें
गुरुजी ने बताया कि भी फल होगा तो टोकरी में रख दो साधक ले जाएगा और उसका डोनेशन बॉक्स बाजू में रख दो कभी फल बेचना नहीं
आफ्टर द स्प्रेड ऑफ धम्मा इन इंडिया फॉर अ डेकेड गोयंकाजी कंडक्टेड हिज फर्स्ट इंटरनेशनल कोर्स इन फ्रांस followed by numerous courses in Europe, Canada, and USA. Long before Goenkaji's visits, roots of Dhamma were already getting established there. Old students were vigorously spreading Dhamma through short courses, talks, etc.
It was a non-center course, very small place, but very expensive. Only 40 people could sit. But after the course, when I gave Dana, I asked how much rent it is. And then she said, $2,000 a month. I said, my goodness, who pays? A few old foreigners who could at that time teach English, they pulled together every month, 5 courses a year only.
Before establishment of permanent centers, Dhamma houses were started in various cities for group sittings and to carry out different outreach programs. In Oak Tree Dhamma House in UK, old students formed a Dhamma community to strengthen their practice and to inspire others to walk on the path.
It was the contact address for Vipassana in the UK at that time. People from all over the world came through there and stayed weeks there at a time. We lived a communal, shared life together. We meditated morning and evening together. We had a lovely meditation room upstairs. We meditated. We were all young people and just starting out in Dharma. So, you know, we organizing the courses that happened in the UK. Goenkaji came and visited the house.
Till 1979, Goenkaji was not able to travel outside India due to the restrictions on his Burmese passport. During this time, He kept on encouraging few other students of Sayagyi U Ba Khin to conduct courses outside India.
Mr. Hubber and John Coleman and Mrs. Dennison learned a lot from him, and they kind of organized their courses much more on the way he did things, because they realized that he had kind of figured out a system for handling large numbers of students, and they followed pretty much how he did it.
For various reasons, these experiments were not successful, and the demand for courses was ever growing. By 1981, Goenkaji was at a watershed. At this time, Goenkaji decided to follow the footsteps of his teacher and authorized few of his well-established students to teach Vipassana on his behalf. By early 1982, initial 8 assistant teachers had been appointed to conduct courses as Goenkaji's representatives. Shortly after their appointment, the first 80-led course was conducted by Mr. Bill Hart in March 1982 in Burmese Vihara, Bodh Gaya, India.
So before I left Dhammagiri, they did give me a plastic bag that was full with all sorts of different tapes of whatever was available. And at that time, they had recorded all his discourses, and on self-courses, we used to play Anapana Vipassana Metta. And I guess they had recorded the instructions throughout the day as well, and the morning chanting, of course. We didn't have the meditation hall. There was a group of Burmese pilgrims using the meditation hall, what was, I think, the library?
Upstairs?
Yes. So we weren't that many people. We crowded into the room where Goenkaji had done his self-courses for about 10 years. And that was our meditation hall. And the first day I played all the different tapes, and we got to the evening discourse, and the students had not yet all run away. They were still there. And the discourse ended, and I breathed a sigh of relief. Okay, now just one sitting and then it will finish. So they came back into the hall after the break, and I pressed the button on the tape player for the evening instructions. Nothing there. And I was completely unprepared. And Goenkaji had just met with the very first assistant teachers and had emphasized to them that when the tapes break down, you have to be able to jump in on a moment's notice. So I managed to figure out what I thought was the instruction for day one evening, and I gave the instruction. And then silence, and they continued meditating, and the time is passing. And then I'm thinking to myself, what happens at 9 o'clock? How do I get them out of the hall? And I guess I wasn't smart enough just to think, at 9 o'clock, I could say, okay, take rest. I thought, I have to do what Goenkaji does, which is chant Bhavatu Sabba Mangalam.
The newly launched AT program opened the doors wider for the spread of Dhamma. To support the AT program, systematic capturing of Goenkaji's wonderful presentation was required. It was not an easy task, as Goenkaji insisted that it be recorded live. As always, Dhamma helped. Someone stepped up to fulfill the need.
Teaching ka format to wahi hai jo pehle tha, originally tha. Uska jo presentation jo aaj video aur audio se jo hai, उसकी शुरुआत थॉमस ने की गुरुजी के साथ छाया की तरह रख के और उसने सब टेप्स शुरू किए और आज का जो फॉर्मेट है वो उस हिसाब से चल रहा है जो थॉमस ने शुरू किया
Bill was going to go back and teach a course at the Burmese Vihara in Bodh Gaya. And I noticed he had a few little tapes. He had a Vipassana tape and an Anapana tape and maybe some discourses or something, but they were all just in a little brown paper bag. So I remember thinking, seeing Bill Hart sitting there waiting for his train, that how terrifying that must be for him, to go and represent his teacher for the first time. Anybody has represented our teacher. And he had nothing but just a little brown bag full of a few tapes. And the rest of it he had to do himself. And I just imagine how terrifying that
was. Guruji, se pehle, har stage pe, he took guidance from Guruji.
And I had some experience in audio and video. And so I tried to talk to Goenkaji about allowing me to record his course in the summer when he came to the U.S. And at first he said no. He said, no, that would be much too distracting for the student, somebody running around and making all these distractions during the course and so forth. So I promised him that I would be quiet as a little mouse.
Through Mr. Thomas Christman's dedicated efforts from 1982 to 86, a complete set of Goenkaji's teaching became available to the assistant teachers. Once available, Goenkaji instructed that for all time to come and at all places, these recordings should be used to keep the teaching and tradition unchanged.
And here is Goenkaji coming to India from Burma with the mission of getting Dhamma established in India so it could spread around the world. How else was it going to spread around the world unless the people who were here practicing were going to start conducting courses? And then, you know, fortunately, Thomas started recording, so we didn't have to know very much.
Format ek hi hai, timing ek hi hai, to har aadmi ko maloom hai ki us time kya hone wala hai. That makes things much easier. Aur mere khayal se, this is a unique example. Mere khayal se dusra example nahi hai ki the courses are held in such a way that the teaching cannot change. Agar live hota, kitna bhi kabil aadmi hota, wo ya to kuch add karta ya subtract karta. And the whole meaning changes. So, वो एक longer टिक सकेगा मुझे ऐसा लगता है because of this.
By using recordings, it prevented the personality of the AT from getting involved with the presentation. Certainly, the AT has a role to play in answering the students' questions, but the constraint on having to rely on Goenkaji's wonderful presentation and obviously discourses, that it relegated the AT to a position where his personality and ego didn't get inflamed.
These recordings ensured that Goenkaji's precise instructions, analogies, dohas and stories would keep on captivating and inspiring generations of students.
One feels so happy. I'm 20 years old. Birthday party. Big celebration. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Poor chap doesn't understand. He's 20 years nearer his graveyard. Got happy. This does not mean that whenever your birthday comes, you start crying. I'm nearer 1 year to be. Oh no. Dhamma does not teach you to cry. You understand the reality. This is the fact.
Goenkaji was very particular not to encourage any kind of gurudam. He himself preferred to be called a Kalyan Mitra, a friend focused on others' welfare. This was a message for the future generations as well. Not to take the teacher's status too seriously and be a mere friend.
Buddha was so clear that I cannot liberate you. You have to liberate yourself. I can only show you the path. If Buddha cannot liberate anybody, who can liberate? Each individual has to work one's own salvation. Someone can show the path, that's all. So whenever in any teaching of Dhamma, the teacher says that I will liberate you, there is something wrong. And for future also, I keep on telling my student, if the teacher starts making this a business for one's livelihood, then the Dhamma will get spoiled. Dhamme nana vanikam chare. Don't make Dhamma a commercial item. So these two things one has to take care in future also.
While designing the AT program, Goenkaji incorporated the code of conduct for assistant teachers, upholding the highest principles in this tradition to maintain the purity of the technique.
Well, he was particularly concerned about three
three issues. One was to do with the golden rule, if you like, that teachers of Dhamma should never receive any kind of financial gain, financial remuneration. The second point was that the teaching should always be non-sectarianism. It shouldn't have anything to do with any organized religion, including Buddhism. It should always be presented in a very non-sectarian. He was also very concerned that the courses should be run on a dana basis. There should never be any kind of charges made for the teaching. And these were golden guidelines he had received from Sayagyi, and this was the tradition coming down through the centuries.
So, what did Guru Ji teach us? That if a sadhak, when we become guru teacher, then the sadhak gives you a bed to sleep, then you don't have to take it. But if they reach the chot, you have to take it, then take it. If that thing comes to the center, then give it to the center. If it doesn't work for the center, you have to keep it. Then you will win the amount of it. The amount of it is more than it, so you will give it a little more. So, we have taught this. How to live in dharma, Krishna is not absolutely not. In our service of dharma, no bhautik labh. I am teaching them in this way, that they feel good for them, and they teach them. So, slowly, 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 it feels good for others. What to learn is, it's not for love, it's not for love, it's not for love, it's not for love. Slowly, slowly, the person who is the person, the person who is the person, they teach them in this way.
Goenka ji always emphasized that if one wants to grow in Dhamma, one needs to serve Dhamma selflessly and tirelessly. Some of such noble servers were chosen by Goenka ji as the first assistant teachers.
Could do one course, two courses, three courses, five courses, no problem. And serving also, sitting, like he says, was so important to sit there, hear people asking the questions, see Goenka ji talking seriously, see how he handled people, how he, some people he was stern, some people he was very soft, some people he would be shouting and, wow, what happened, shouting at us sometimes. So all these years of experience, you know, just really gelled into, wow, yes, this is what I have to do. In
30 days ka course khatam hi kiya tha, bola tum serve karo, matlab ki jahan khana khane aate hain sadhak nazdik ke, to unko khana serve karo, to samajh mein aaya ki kitni problem aati hai. Khane ke liye aata hai, par hum unke samne khade hain, to hum kaise face karte hain usko, to humko kya takleef hoti hai. तो ऐसे ऐसे कई इंसिडेंसेस जब समझ में आए तब मालूम पड़ा कि क्या नहीं करना चाहिए, क्या किस चीज से गलत हो सकता है, किस चीज का ध्यान रखना चाहिए.
It wasn't like we went from zero to 100. I mean, we'd been there and seen Goenka ji in many different situations, how he handled them so confidently. And you know, we'd managed, we'd cooked, we'd built, we'd helped look for centers, so do a lot of jobs. So, you know, it wasn't like we were coming in absolutely fresh.
Seva hi se
mahatvapurna
hai. और काम नहीं, पहले तो ये कि एक ही बनना, हमारे मन में भाव आया कि मैं एक ही बनूं, तो सेवा नहीं है, उसको पद का और भूख है, तर्पण. एक शब्द भी दिया आपने, भूख का जी, मैंने पहल करना, और कुछ नहीं, कोई सेवा करे, अरे मैं भी सेवा करूं, मैं भी सेवा करूं, मैं टीचर बन के सेवा करूं, वो नहीं, मैं भी सेवा करूं, बस इसलिए मेरा प्रशंसा होगी मेरी, कि मुझे कुछ लाभ होगा, वो कुछ मन में ना आए, बस मुझे सेवा करनी है, ये भाव जागना चाहिए. तो वो ही लायक होते हैं सेवा करने के लिए और एक ही बनने के लिए. बाकी मैं एक ही बनूं और मैं ये सेवा करूं, तो वो उसके अंदर अहम भाव है, तो वो लायक नहीं होता है.
उनका यही था कि टीचर होने के नाते उनको मन में करुणा होना चाहिए, करुणा होना चाहिए. जो आया है उसको लाभ हो, से दुखी तो सभी है संसार में, कौन सुखी है. तो करुणा विशेष, गुरुजी कहते थे कि टीचर के मन में करुणा होना चाहिए और उसके प्रति में उसके सहन शक्ति, जिसे अभी नहीं समझा तो फिर समझेगा, फिर समझेगा. नहीं कि नहीं होगा, आप इसको छोड़ दो, ये नहीं होना चाहिए.
These Dhamma messengers are spreading the technique of Vipassana for the benefit of many, for the welfare of many.
The big difference was that he said, you are assistant teacher. So there's the material. We are not teaching. We are just trying to not obstruct the Dhamma to get there. Obviously, he can't push all the buttons himself. He can't be everywhere at the same time.
We had the good fortune to jump on that wheel. You know, we need it a lot more than it needs us. You know, and for Goenkaji to give us that opportunity to help him, he felt that he was still just assisting Sayagyi. Even now, I mean, when you speak to him now, everything he's saying is, this is because of Sayagyi. You know, he's just helping Sayagyi, we're just helping him.
I said to him, what do you remember of Sayagyi U Ba Khin? And he didn't reply very much with any words, but I remember his eyes got rolled back inside themselves, and he went into a sort of a reverie of remembrance of U Ba Khin, and you could, looking in his eyes at that time and seeing them kind of turned inward with a reverential, blissful feeling of his teacher. And somehow also that connected up, you know, having that like an opening into Goenkaji's mind, you know, was like a connection to all the line of teachers. And
so, you know, there was a story that somebody had asked Sayagyi to compare himself to the Buddha. Sayagyi said, if the Buddha was the entire range of the Himalayas, I'm not even a grain of sand to the Himalayas. And then they asked Guruji to do the same thing, and he said, I'm not even a shadow to that grain of sand. So if you think of all of us sitting here, as hard as it is and as incapable as we may feel, we're very lucky.
After establishing a strong base of Patipatti, Goenkaji took up the wider dissemination of Buddhavani, the teachings of the Enlightened One. By his own experience, Goenkaji knew the benefits of combining Pariyatti with Patipatti. With this vision, the Vipassana Research Institute, VRI, was formed in 1985. The principal objectives were to conduct scientific research into the benefits of Vipassana, its impact on society, teaching Pali language, and exploration of the sources of Vipassana in the Tripitaka.
Askar ke mere khayal se Tripitaka ke hisab se zyada un pariyatti pe zyada unka focus tha ki is pe research hona zaruri hai, kyunki usi karan se ye jo format hai Sri Lanka mein aur alag jagah pe accept kiya bhikkhu logon ne, kyunki guruji ki expertise thi pariyatti mein bhi.
Guruji ka ये ख्याल था कि इतना काम फैल रहा है तो एक सेंट्रलाइज्ड जगह होनी चाहिए कि एक तो वहाँ जहाँ से मटेरियल फॉर डिसेमिनेशन ऑफ धम्मा अवेलेबल हो, जो साहित्य है नया नया साहित्य गुरुजी ने रचना की है तो उसका एक प्रॉपर मैनेजमेंट हो, इजीली अवेलेबल भी हो सके और काम आ सके. उस पर्पस से वीआरआई का फॉर्मेशन हुआ.
वन ऑफ द फर्स्ट प्रोजेक्ट्स दैट वीआरआई अंडरटुक वाज द पब्लिकेशन ऑफ द त्रिपिटका, द प्राइसलेस टीचिंग्स ऑफ द बुद्धा. वीआरआई पब्लिश्ड द एंटायर त्रिपिटका इन देवनागरी स्क्रिप्ट अलोंग विद इट्स कमेंट्रीज एंड सब कमेंट्रीज इन 140 वॉल्यूम्स. It used the authentic version as compiled in the 6th Sangaina in Burmese script as its base. After its publication, VRI digitally encoded the entire Tripitaka and made it freely available in 15 important languages of the world.
ये त्रिपिटका गुरुजी ने हाथ में लिया. मैं गुरुजी आप बोलो तो मैं करा दूँ. मैं तो प्रीति को बोलूँगा और वो करने को तैयार है और capable of doing it. If दो शंका ने आपके फिर से बहुत बोझा कम हो जाएगा. प्रीति बहन सब चीज हाथ में लिया, आखिर टीम बनाई, सबको बर्मी सिखाया, सबको ये सिखाया, सबको वो सिखाया करके जबरदस्त टीम तैयार की और काम इतना हो गया कि गुरुजी की अजाय भी लगी कि गजब है.
VRI started residential Pali courses for meditators even when the facilities were primitive. Today, these courses are being conducted in the campus of Global Vipassana Foundation with all the modern facilities.
We started this pariyatti, all the scriptures, Buddha's words and the commentaries and all that. And then we are seeing that what we are doing is exactly according to the words of Buddha. Of course, many people have translated wrongly because they have never practiced Vipassana. So they can't understand the real meaning of some of the words that Buddha used. But when you practice, the words become so clear. And that gives a strength to us that we are doing exactly the same as Buddha wanted us to.
To introduce the original teachings of the Buddha to the new generation, VRI, in affiliation with Mumbai University, has been conducting various degree programs such as MA, PhD, along with various short courses since 2013.
And by reading, I understood more the smaller steps. And I started also to read the Dhammapada. So every little step, I can understand much more. And how important it is to dissect and this and to go deeper. And I got so stimulated to do better meditation, more concentrated.
While Goenkaji expanded the availability of pariyatti, he continued to emphasize patipatti over pariyatti.
Sirf pariyatti se kaam nahi chalega, theory se kaam nahi chalega. Patipatti sadhana karoge tab iska arth samajh mein aayega.
Pali ke pandit hum log ho sakte hain, Pali padha sakte the, lekin jo gyan badha गुरु जी के संपर्क में आने से ज्ञान बढ़ा अपने को।
इन सती और संपजय का अर्थ मैं नहीं जानता। ये साधना करने पर मुझे पता चल गया कि क्या सती होती है, क्या संपजय होता है।
देखिए, he gave all importance to patipatti, but then he said for advancement, study of pariyatti is also essential, लेकिन not at the cost of patipatti.
Wider dissemination of pariyatti added force to the principal tool of spread of Dhamma, word of mouth or ehi passiko.
Word of mouth is the word of real experience. Somebody experiences and tells others, well, I've experienced it, it's so good. But when we start advertising by these medias, then it becomes more a commercial publicity and it won't have that effect. And moreover, we have our own limitation. These courses are residential courses, and there must be facility for people to stay and practice. From the time we started working, whatever facility we had is always full. And as the facility grows, more people come. If more people come and there is no facility, what is the use of this calling people by publicity? So as much people as they come by words of mouth, the facility is available, and that much is good enough. And like the slow widening of the circle is again the purity of it.
In the initial years, it was amazing to see the spread of Dhamma even when no mode of mass communication was employed.
We were in Bombay and I met a person, a woman who I had met in Goa, and we were discussing about different meditation techniques. She had just come back from a course and her face was just glowing. And I remember we were checking into the Stifel's Hotel and she said, just go and do this course. Yeah. So we packed our 3.5-year-old daughter. We went halfway across India in the luggage rack of a second or third class train. And we ended up in Sevagram, which was a Gandhi ashram. And fortunately for us, we had no idea. You know, we had no idea about anything other than this is where the course is and you used to go there.
The early 70s, where an awful lot of Westerners were on a kind of a circuit running to Goa when it too cold in the north, they'd go down, going here and there. And so the overland route was populated with Westerners traveling from Europe to India. So that network of people on the road, and the contact was always one face to face. It was always a one-on-one reportage of what a course was like.
Well, you know, in those early days, you know, the Western students who were sitting with Guruji, they became very inspired to want to help the Dhamma in any way. And they tried to help get a Dhamma established in their home countries, gypsy camps in Western country. And it just sort of snowballed, you know. People became more inspired with the success. And Guruji gave them all the encouragement to help, you know, help the Dhamma spread and to reach those people who weren't able to travel to India. So it just evolved like that. And what we see today, you know, in just every country around the world, there are these courses being held. And it's been just a natural progression as this, as the Dhamma spread out.
Over time, grateful old students started to acquaint people with this technique through various media. Many started to write books. The first one being The Art of Living by Mr. Bill Hart. Others made films and documentaries for the wider spread of Vipassana.
People came to courses because they heard about it from somebody they know, usually. There were hardly any news articles, and the only thing that was shot on video in our courses or of Goenkaji was the discourses. I realized if I want to help him so that the whole world will hear about it, it has to go through mass media, and mass media in those days was television or cinemas.
These efforts played an important role in informing people about this life-changing technique. Dhamma.org website was launched in 1996, followed by VRI website in 1998. They helped in providing unified platforms for dissemination of information and inspiring people worldwide.
So many factors that all needed to be there for the sasana to be revived, such as a common language, a world language had arisen, English. Technology had come into existence that enabled the spread of Dhamma, that instead of one person having to go around the world giving all these courses, the courses could be recorded and taped, and so many courses could be happening all over the world with this material. So I think it's remarkable that they all came together at that time to enable the spread of Dhamma, so it, definitely not a coincidence at all.
Goenkaji travelled extensively to give discourses and speeches at various national and international fora to spread the light of this rare gem. At the ripe age of 76, he undertook a strenuous 120-day trip across USA and Canada, travelling in a camper. This gave further impetus to the growth of centers in India and around the world. Centers in India were multiplying fast. The first international center, Dhamma Dhara, in Massachusetts, USA, was planned in 1982. This was followed by 16 more centers in North America and 8 in Latin America. Dhamma Bhumi, the first center in Australia, was established in 1983, followed by 7 more centers in Oceania. Dhamma Mahi, the first center in France, was established in 1988, followed by 14 more centers in Europe. Dhamma Pataka, the first center in South Africa, was established in 2005, and regular non-center courses are being conducted all over Africa. Dhamma Pamoda, the first center in the Middle East, was developed in 2014. Russia is served by a center, Dhamma Dullabha. In several regions of the world, non-center courses supplement the courses in Vipassana centers. 148 centers are located in Asia, with 88 centers in India and multiple centers in Myanmar, Nepal, Sri Lanka, Thailand, Japan, Taiwan, Cambodia, and China. While this spread of centers made access to the path of Dhamma easily available in many places, he took steps to help those who were keen to benefit from meditating continuously for longer periods. He developed 20, 30, 45, and 60 days long courses with their unique instructions and discourses. This effort of Goenkaji has also proven very beneficial for many students. As the time ripened, Dhamma Tapovan, a center dedicated to long courses, was established in 1999. Besides Dhamma Tapovan, many of the centers offer long courses of different duration. Simultaneously, courses of shorter duration were developed to strengthen daily practice of the students. Today, there are 197 centers and 137 non-center locations in more than 100 countries. These centers are supported by dedicated Dhamma servers and technological platform provided by VRI and Dhamma.org. Courses are available in more than 55 languages. This spread of Dhamma was not without difficulties. Problems were unique to each country and even to each course. Whatever the problem, the volition of servers and the ever-benevolent Dhamma had a solution.
So the day we bought VMC, there was a large town meeting in Shelburne Falls, Massachusetts. They were all very concerned that that we would be on the streets, wearing strange clothing, selling flowers, talking to their children, basically trying to take over the town. And we promised the authorities that we would be good neighbors, that we would not be doing the things that they were concerned about. Now it has been about 37 years. We have excellent relations with the town. One of the local officials even told us, he said, how we've become a very important part of the town.
Well, we had so many, you know, with Dhamma Bhumi starting right from the, but we have to, there's no, we, you know, in the West there, we have to dig our own ditches and do all the work. You know, occasionally they get in some contractor, but mainly it's the old students that are doing all the hard physical work, right? The building, the digging of the trenches, the everything. So, but people, it's just, it nearly becomes automatic, you know, I mean, people just want to serve, want to help, want to, you know, want the Dharma to spread. It seems to be nearly an automatic process.
In this Kyoto Center, the government wanted to have a new road, and they wanted to build a big road. Right, it going through our center, it's just going to destroy the center, we can't continue. So we kept having these meetings with the government authorities. And it seems at one point it was impossible. And I remember talking to Guruji, look, it just seems like we might even have to give up Dhamma Bhanu. And Goenkaji listened and said, Dhamma will work. No. He wasn't worried at all. So it turned out in the end that instead of having the road right in the middle of the property, they shifted it to the end. And they cut the side of the mountain and they built the road there. It took a little bit of our land, but actually this old road, which was right in the middle of our property, that was became ours.
कच्छ में आश्रम बनाना था, ऐसा केंद्र बनाना था. हम काफ़ी जगह सोचते थे, कोई अनुकूल नहीं आती थी. ऐसे करते करते करीब 15 साल बाद इगतपुरी शुरू हुई तब तब एक जगह मिली।
5 महीने में वहाँ सेंटर शुरू हो गया। काफी दिक्कत होते हुए भी इतना इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर बना गया कि 5 महीने क्रॉप निकाला, इतने देर में ड्राइंग्स वगैरह बनाया, ड्राइंग्स वो जगह बन गई थी तो हमने मशीन लगा करके ब्लॉक्स बनाना शुरू कर दिया।
मजे की क्या बात है कि इनको रहने की कोई जगह नहीं थी, कहाँ रहे, खुला था, कोई मकान नहीं था, तो एक झोपड़ी थी चौकीदार की, तो वहाँ बाहर खटिया डाल के रहते थे।
काफी डिफिकल्टीज आ गई उसमें, मगर हमारा काम चला और 1990 में गुरुजी वहाँ पधारे।
समुद्र तट पे बैठ कर के गुरुजी ने एक घंटा साधना की कि अरबी समुद्र तू वहाँ से धर्म का संदेश ले जा और देश पर देश इसको बांट दू, जन जन के हित के लिए बांट देश पर देश।
There was a group who were taken by two monks who'd done courses in Taiwan. They came back to Malaysia and told all the people in their temple, you must learn Vipassana. So 35 people, I think something like that, went with them to Nepal and sat the first course. At the end of the course, they saw a video that had been made in Dhammagiri about how to organize and serve a course. And they saw that video and said, oh, I think we could do that. So they all went back to Malaysia and rented a camp in a temple and invited one of the teachers from Nepal to conduct the first two courses. So they started organizing more and more non-center courses, and eventually they did get to, I think, 1 year, 13 non-center courses in 1 year. They had to take all the equipment, all the mattresses. They even had a big commercial refrigerator. By then we had a Dhamma house in Kuala Lumpur, and downstairs was the storage of all the equipment, and upstairs was a group sitting place. But downstairs we kept all the equipment, and they'd get a big truck for every course, load everything into the truck, and all the old students would come and help with the loading, and then take it 3-4 hours to the course site, unload everything, set up the site. Sometimes there was no kitchen. A lot of work for all those gypsy courses. It took a long time to get a center in Malaysia again.
कि जिम्बाब्वे में कोर्स लग रहा था, 20 आदमी थे, तो हमारा मिनिमम 20 पीपल हो तो ही कोर्स लगे, पर फिर कोई कम हुआ, कैंसिल हुआ, तो 10 लोग हुए, तो गुरुजी के अनाउंस किया हुआ कोर्स कैंसिल नहीं करना। तो यहाँ से वो तलवार जी थे, तापड़िया जी थे, अपना खुद का खर्चा करके जाते थे, तो कि वहाँ से हमने एक टीचर अपन यहाँ से इंडिया से भेजे, उन्हें खाना बाहर से आता था, वो भी परमिट किया। नॉन साधक थे वो भी किचन में रहेंगे तो रहेंगे, तो ये इस करके करके धर्म चखे।
When the first course in Israel happened, were 70 some students. Later on, courses started happening as we could give them. I mean, the demand was always strong here. Not enough Dhamma workers who set the courses and could provide more courses. And so I used to come here periodically and help organize more and more courses through the years. About 9 years after we had gypsy camps, we realized the thirst cannot be quenched in Israel. We have to rent a place where we can actually give 25 courses a year. We didn't have the money to buy a center or buy a land. And so we rented a place in the desert, a cheap place. The accommodations were poor. The more courses we provided, the more the demand grew. For over 10 years, we managed to operate a gypsy center, a place that was rented, but was actually operated like any established center in the world, giving full-on courses. And so more generations of meditators grew and started serving Dhamma. And when we purchased the land near the Sea of Galilee in Israel, it was, again, a problem of money. We didn't have money. We went to Goenkaji. He was always optimistic, and he was always telling us, it will be solved. You will have a center. He was very happy with the site that we found, the name that he gave the center, Dhamma Pamoda.
Pamodam is happiness.
We had been holding courses at this one student's house for the last 10, 12 years. The main volcano in Hawaii blew, and the place where we were holding these courses was just inundated and everything. We lost every single thing we had. But what happened was that the students rose up, well, we're not going to let this stop us. And they got together, and now we have two courses scheduled for March of next year. So we're rising from the fire, or the phoenix. We're the phoenix rising from the fire.
The first course was organized in Latin America, where the only two servers to serve that course in Panama. So it happened that very important people came to sit that course, wives of government people. So it was a very, very complicated course, and I'm sure in many senses failing the minimum standards. To such an extent that in one of the early days, one of the women leaves the course and tells her husband of her friend, who her friend was sitting the course, and she stayed. And she tells the husband, who is one of the Supreme Court judges, that your wife is sitting this course and it's all a sect and it's all crazy and things are not working well. The food, the timetable, the discipline, everything is totally incoherent. The husband is very shocked. Oh, my poor wife, I have to save her. So he, being the judge of the Supreme Court, calls the police and has the course stopped and interrogate the students. And they did that twice. But still the course continues until day 7. People leave with metta, very happy, as a 7-day course instead of a 10-day course.
Last year, till last year, we had 8 centers, you know. So this year we have 13 and a half, right? You know, what is half? You know? Half is a unique center. We are, you know, just decided, you know, that we may have. You know, that's a bhikkhu center.
Jada dhani desh nahi hai, garib desh hai. तो गरीब देश होते हुए भी 12-14 सेंटर अभी तो अभी अभी हमने सुने आज ही सुने हैं कि माउंट एवरेस्ट है उसके बेस के आसपास एक सेंटर बन गया है और उसका नाम धम्म सागर रख दिया क्योंकि सागर माँ का नेपाली नाम है एवरेस्ट का तो इस प्रकार जो है फैल रहा है
द रीजन बिहाइंड दिस फेनोमिनल स्प्रेड वाज द यूनिवर्सल नेचर ऑफ दिस टेक्निक एंड गोयनका जी इज नॉन सेक्टेरियन वे ऑफ प्रेजेंटिंग इट As a result, people from different backgrounds accepted it wholeheartedly.
Teaching itni powerful thi ki wo spread ho gayi. Now we taught it as a way of living. It had nothing to do, in fact, it has nothing to do with religion.
What appealed to me as a young analyst and a financial journalist was that here was Guruji saying that your experience is the only truth. I was not expected to come here with any beliefs or preconceived notions, no dogmas. And that, to a young mind, was very appealing.
Basic message there which resonated with both Westerners and Indians, maybe in different ways, but it was a basic message that this is something universal and non-sectarian.
Many households are practicing Vipassana more and more now, and we all owe it much to Guruji. Yes, his discourses are always so inspiring and so reasonable. You have to be very reasonable, you see. Otherwise, especially young people can be very rebellious. They have to see the reason, they have to understand. Once they understand, more than half the problem is solved.
In 2012, Goenkaji took a landmark decision to teach Anapan freely to one and all. Many who were reluctant to take a 10-day Vipassana course felt encouraged to take a course after tasting the benefits of Anapana.
Dhamma have to spread now. It has started. It is just a beginning. A few drops in the ocean, it will spread, no doubt about it. Every village or every district has got a school, a hospital. Similarly, a time will come when every village, every district, every city will have meditation centers, Vipassana centers. It was so necessary for the society.
After tirelessly spreading Dhamma for the benefit of the present generation, time had ripened to build a magnificent stupa to act as a physical beacon of Dhamma and attract visitors to the scientific teaching of Buddha for centuries to come. The custom of building such monuments has been an ancient practice in India. Mahaparinibbana Sutta describes the manner in which the body relics of the Buddha should be enshrined in a dhatu gabbha or a relic store for the meditators to benefit from and pay respect to. Meditating in the presence of relics is possibly the best way to do so. Following the same August tradition, the global Vipassana pagoda enshrining the original bone relics of the Buddha was built near Mumbai.
In India, where there is a lot of misconception about the Buddha, he had this incredible idea of building a monument that it will draw so many people because of this phenomenal structure. And then when they are there already, they can learn about the Buddha. They can hear about the Buddha. They can see in the gallery his life story over paintings.
Goenkaji conceived of a project such that it would meet several other objectives as well. Constructed with the ancient technique of building domes by interlocking stones, supplemented by modern construction tools, the magnificent pillarless dome of the pagoda has a capacity to seat 8,000 meditators at a time.
The idea of having a pagoda that is hollow so that people can meditate inside was Sayagyi's idea. He just made a grandiose structure where thousands of people would be able to sit together and meditate. And that was a very important part of global pagoda, the practice.
Its design is based on the famous Shwedagon pagoda in Myanmar as an expression of gratitude for preserving the practice of Vipassana in its pure form. Announced on the birth centenary year of Sayagyi U Ba Khin, the pagoda is also a homage to the shining star of Dhamma. Since its inauguration in 2009, thousands of visitors daily visit the global Vipassana pagoda to see this architectural marvel and its attractive Burmese style decor. In addition, they learn about the life and teaching of the Buddha, obtain information about Vipassana, and get initiated in Anapana meditation.
बहुत बड़ा खर्च था तो हमने सब बात किया कि गुरुजी ये अपने गज्जे के ऊपर से काम लेते हैं तो कैसा होगा बताते थे कि देखो अपना दृढ़ निश्चय होगा ना तो होगा ही उसमें होने में कोई फर्क नहीं पड़ेगा पर निश्चय अभी तुम बोलते हो ऐसा ढीला कर देगा ना तो नहीं होगा और जो निश्चय से गुरुजी ने किया जो फाइनेंशियल मुझवण कभी कभी आती थी वो कैसा निकल जाती थी वो मालूम नहीं पड़ता गुरु जी ये बोलते थे इसमें कि जो आदमी सच्चाई से कम करता है किसके लिए खराब नहीं करता है किसके लिए सबके लिए अच्छा ही इच्छता है वो अगर मनोबल करे कि अगर मैं ये किया वो सब बराबर आए तो ये मेरा काम होना चाहिए ऐसा तीन दफे तुम बोलो वो काम होते ही रहे
Each and every part of the pagoda inspires visitors to walk on the Noble Eightfold Path taught by the Buddha. The broad base and the square terraces of the pagoda signify suffering. The octagonal terraces symbolize morality. The bell-shaped middle portion represents concentration and the uppermost part, wisdom. It is important to remember that more than the pagoda, it is a meditator ardently practicing vipassana inside the pagoda who truly represents the Buddha, Dhamma and the Sangha. Due to the persistent efforts of grateful vipassana meditators, Dhamma started to proliferate amongst all sections of the society.
But when we have to improve the society, we can't forget individual. Man matters most. And when we have to improve the man, then we can't forget the mind. The mind has to be improved. And for that, Dharma is the only remedy. No other remedy is there. And Dharma also applied Dharma.
Vipassana's extensive spread was possible only because it made an impact at the individual level.
Guruji was sahi maane mein fatherly figure to all of us. Unhone hume sadhne ke zariye bahut kuch sikhaya ki kathinai ke samay mein bhi aap kaise tatasth rahenge. Usse meri life mein shanti badh gayi aur mera parivar ke saath dusre logon ke saath jo sambandh the wo sambandh mein bhi bahut बदलाव आया और कोई टेंशन तो है ही नहीं तो हम ऐसा एहसास करते हैं कि एक जीवन जीने की कला जो हमको नहीं मालूम थी वो ये साधना के जरिए हमें मालूम पड़ा कि अपनी लाइफस्टाइल हम कैसे खुद हम कैसे बदलाव कर सकते हैं और सुख शांति के समीप हम जा सकते हैं
भले मेरा एकदम गुस्से वाला स्वभाव था कॉन्ट्रैक्टर आप समझते हैं कैसे होते हैं ऐसा गुस्से वाला स्वभाव था मगर धीमे 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 ऐसा कि मेरे पास जो काम करने वाले आदमी थे ना वो जैसे कि घर का आदमी कैसे होते हैं परिवार जैसा हो गया
I had a very wild life before that. So I came out from very heavy Western partying and alcohol and drugs and everything. But I knew it would, even before I did the course, I knew it would change my life. I knew this would make the difference. So even in that course, the alcohol left.
People of all backgrounds benefit by walking on this life-transforming noble path, experiencing peace and happiness. Their peace permeates their surroundings as well. Vipassana has proved to be a powerful tool to come out of addictions, and it can also help to promote better all-round mental well-being. In many countries, Vipassana has been used as a tool to rehabilitate drug addicts and war veterans. VRI undertakes research and publishes papers on the practical application of Vipassana on its own and in association with the National Institute of Mental Health and Neurosciences, Bangalore.
कई conferences organize करी गुरुजी ने psychiatrist लोगों के लिए विगतपुरी में हुई थी उसमें invite किए गए psychotherapist, psychiatrist और उनके अपने अपने अनुभव उन्होंने बताया कि भाई Vipassana से लोगों पे क्या प्रभाव होता है क्या फर्क पड़ता है और उस वक्त डिप्रेशन के केस बहुत आते थे जब गुरुजी कंडक्ट कर रहे थे अभी भी आते हैं तो उनको कई लोगों को बहुत फायदा हुआ, लेकिन गुरु जी हमेशा बहुत ध्यान रखते थे कि लोग अपनी बीमारी को ठीक करने नहीं आए, क्योंकि वो गलत रास्ते पे चले जाएंगे।
In the last 50 years, Vipassana has proven to be a great unifying force in our strife-torn society. People of all castes, color, creed, and economic strata sit the courses, meditate, and serve together.
हर संस्था में बड़े लोगों को देखा जाता बेटा, है ना? कोई मिनिस्टर है, कोई लीडर है, कोई मतलब इंडस्ट्रियल मालिक है, कुछ है, उनको आगे बिठाया जाता है। मगर ये धर्म के जो तपोभूमियाँ जितने हैं, वहाँ पर उसको नहीं देखते, कोर्स देखते हैं, कितने कोर्स किए हैं, कितने कोर्स किए हैं, उसके अनुसार उसको आगे बिठाते हैं। तो ये धर्म की मान हुई ना, धन की नहीं।
One of the major sections that benefited from Vipassana is business and profession.
In businesses, nothing is permanent. I mean, if success is not permanent, good times are not permanent, so are bad times not permanent. Either you are worried about the past or you are anxious about the future. And anxiety and worries bring stress.
The management programs give you skills and Vipassana gives you wisdom. And the higher you go in the organization, you can hire skill, you cannot hire wisdom. So I think it's unique.
My top executive team, I sent everybody of them to do a Vipassana camp. Their performance improved, their quality improved, their human relation and behavior and teamwork, that improved. So this greatly helped me in building up a better team of my management.
In the organizations where many people practice Vipassana, the whole atmosphere gets permeated with the vibrations of peace and tranquility. In 1972, when Goenka ji met Acharya Vinoba Bhave, the great saint of India, even while he seemed impressed with the technique, he also posed a challenge. I will accept Vipassana only if it gives good results to two segments of the society, hardened criminals and school children. Little did he know that the practice of holding Vipassana courses in prisons was a very common one in Emperor Asoka's time.
जो छोड़ने लायक हो उनको सुधार कर छोड़ा जाता था, जो छोड़ने लायक नहीं हो दंड देना हो तो भी जितना सुधर सके उतना सुधार करके उनको दंड दिया जाए, मृत्यु का दंड दिया जाए। कितना बड़ा परिवर्तन। और ये विद्या ऐसी है कि परिवर्तन आता ही है, काम करे आदमी तो परिवर्तन आता ही है।
ड्यू टू द परसिस्टेंट एफर्ट्स ऑफ राम सिंह जी, द देन होम सेक्रेटरी ऑफ राजस्थान, the first Vipassana course in prison was conducted in Jaipur Central Jail in October 1975.
Shivir laga, kuch log aise the jinko mrityu dand diya gaya, to wo ek ek solitary cell mein band hain. Sham ko jo pravachan hote the unko broadcast kiya jata tha, to wo log ab ja nahi sakte, to unhone kaha, unme se ek ne kaha, sardar tha wo, कि कहा गुरु महाराज जो कहिए कि हमको यहाँ आकर कुछ सिखा दे, कितना सीख पाएगा। लेकिन अब बेचारे को मृत्यु दंड मिला है, कुछ दिनों के बाद तो इसे फांसी होने वाली है। तो गया मैं उसे सिखाया, बहुत व्याकुल। जिस आदमी को मृत्यु दंड मिला, सोच के देखो उसकी मन की कैसी अवस्था होगी, कितना व्याकुल, कितना व्याकुल। उसे आनापान दी और ऐसा हुआ, तीन दिन के बाद तैयार हो गया, विपश्यना भी दे दी। अब बताते हैं जिन्होंने उसे फांसी पर ले गए लटकाने के लिए, इतना मुस्कुराते हुए जाता है, अरे हमारा परलोक सुधर जाएगा, हम मरने से डरने वाले नहीं। कितना बड़ा परिवर्तन आया, कभी ये देश में होता था इस प्रकार?
After successful completion of the prison courses in Jaipur and Vadodara, a major course was arranged in the largest jail of India, Tihar. This historical course was conducted by Goenka ji, Mata ji and 13 assistant teachers for over 1,000 inmates.
उन्होंने कहा एक बात का ख्याल करना है, जो इनमेट्स को भोजन वगैरह मिलता है आपको वही भोजन करना है, कुछ भी बाहर से मंगवाना नहीं है, और आप कुछ लाए हो तो उसका भी उपयोग नहीं करना है।
Due to its success, Vipassana is a regular feature in this jail to date, producing wonderful results. It later became a subject of an inspiring film, Doing Time, Doing Vipassana, which played a crucial role in introducing Vipassana in prisons all over the world.
We came in with the blessings of Kiran Bedi, the chief of Tihar jails, who they adored and admired. It was the last day of the course in Tihar that we met Mustafa, the Somalian meditator, asked him to sit for an interview. And as he was talking about his experience in Dhamma, we realized we have a film. We met Doing Time, Doing Vipassana. It was a success. It drew many people to Vipassana.
After witnessing the impressive results of the Tihar jail course, the Ministry of Home Affairs proposed to introduce Vipassana as a reform measure in all the prisons in India.
Ashur jail mein 74 courses ho gaye 4 saal mein, wahan jinke courses ho gaye the roz practice chal rahi thi, hum logon ne us samay unko tape recorder diye the, jab unka sunset ke baad unko band kar rahe the to uske andar wo roz raat mein wo disco sunenge, chanting sunenge, aise ek barrack mein wo 70-80 log rehte hain, तो उसमें से मिक्स रहता है। तो उन्होंने कहा कि ऐसे करो, जिन लोगों ने कोर्स किया सभी लोग एक बैरक में रखो, ऐसे 70। तो क्या कि हम लोग फिर सिगरेट नहीं पियेंगे, तम्बाकू नहीं खाएंगे, ये करेंगे और रात में बैठ के ध्यान करेंगे करके। तो वो आई जी को अच्छा लगा, तो हमें ऐसे बैरक दे दी थी, फिर हम लोगों ने ग्रुप सीटिंग लिए, सब कुछ था, टेप रिकॉर्डर लगा के उन्हें करते थे। इससे अच्छा था कि वो जो गार्ड है ड्यूटी पर वो खुश थे, तो वो केवल प्रवचन सुन के कि उसकी ड्यूटी है तो वो बाहर बैठ के प्रवचन सुनते थे, उसने आके कोर्स कर दिया।
Several other countries have also introduced Vipassana in their prisons. The government of Rajasthan took a pioneering decision of training police officers and jail staff in Vipassana. Several other state governments also use this technique for reforms in administration and prisons. It is good to start young.
And the Anapana gives them concentration and helps them with all the usual teenager issues of being able to not be subject to peer pressure, not be able, be able to be confident with who they are and recognize the difference between wholesome and unwholesome acts.
1984, Aparna Toshniwal, a girl from the 8th standard, she did her first 10-day course, and when she came back, she wrote to Guruji after 2 months and said, "Why don't you have a course for children? A little playful, a light course." And that is how the idea was given to Guruji. It was after 2 years, in April 1986, that the first course took place in Jamnabai School in Mumbai.
Subsequent to the success of this first course, regular children courses started in various states of India. One such state was Gujarat.
हमने एक प्रयोग शुरू किया, एक तालुके को लिया, उसके हर एक गांव की, हर एक स्कूल के हर एक बच्चे को आनापान एक दिन के 5 घंटे के शिविर में सिखाया और गुरुजी को रिपोर्ट लिखा कि 75,000 चिल्ड्रन हैव बीन टॉट इन वन डे कोर्स इन कच्छ।
इन 2012 महाराष्ट्र गवर्नमेंट एंड वीआरआई स्टार्टेड मित्र प्रोजेक्ट टू टीच आनापान इन ऑल द गवर्नमेंट स्कूल्स।
मित्र MITRA, Mind in Training for Right Awareness, उसका रिजल्ट बहुत अच्छा है। अभी महाराष्ट्र में अबाउट 65,000 स्कूल्स हैं जो 5th स्टैंडर्ड से 10th स्टैंडर्ड तक है, तो उसमें से सभी स्कूल में चला गया है, तो उसमें उनके भाषा में उनको सील देते हैं, समझा देते, और फिर वो रोज़ सुबह स्कूल स्टार्ट होती है 10 मिनट और स्कूल का समय 10 मिनट, वो सभी उधर शुरू हो गया है.
Soon after the successful launch in India, similar initiatives started in the Western countries as well.
So we took the material for the mitra that they use in India, and we developed what we call the mitra pack, and we've made this pack available to any meditator who is a school teacher.
A dedicated team of Dhamma servers is regularly conducting Anapana courses for street children and underprivileged sections of the society. Regular children courses are conducted in several countries of the world. Similarly, 7-day teenagers Vipassana courses are being conducted in India, Myanmar, and Nepal. The clock of Vipassana has truly struck. From the time that Sayagyi U Ba Khin sent Goenka ji to India in 1969, many hands have come forward to spread Dhamma far and wide. Yet, it is only a beginning. True peace in the world is possible only when each individual is transformed. There are many challenges in reaching that goal.
There is a saying that India lost Dhamma after 500 years. But that you can lose it after 500 years, first you have to preserve it for 500 years.
देखिए परिवार जैसे बढ़ता है तो थोड़े बहुत differences तो आते ही हैं. लेकिन अगर बेसिक वैल्यूज स्ट्रांग हो और लोग उसको फॉलो करें तो गुरुजी ने जो कहा है ना कि डेली प्रैक्टिस जरूरी है. अगर हम डेली प्रैक्टिस करते रहेंगे तो ये चैलेंजेस बहुत मुश्किल नहीं. साधना छूट जाएगी तो मार अपना काम करेगा. तो एक ही उपाय है कि हम अपने प्रैक्टिस पे बल रखें, ये भरोसा रखें कि धर्म जो कुछ करेगा अच्छा करेगा और धर्म ही हमारा सहारा है और गुरु जी को एग्जाम्पल रख के करेंगे तो मुश्किलें आएंगी निकलती जाएंगी चलता रहेगा.
Very clearly he said, you people are the road sweepers, you're cleaning a path for Dhamma. So sometimes people think, oh how fortunate you were, you know, you're with Goenka ji in those early years, but actually we are people who, you know, we've done what little we can to help clear the way, but people with far greater parami, far more developed people will be coming in the future, and they will face their own challenges. It will be quite different than what we faced.
I think to the next generation, and even this generation, we have to be very, very alert and very, very careful. And we're finding that in being alert to things that distract us from our mission, and our mission is spreading seeds of Dhamma, just like Goenka ji did. That was his mission, that is our mission.
In the journey so far, enormous challenges were overcome by the Dhamma servers, relying on the strength of their humility, dedication, and regular practice. These torchbearers will remain shining examples for generations to come.
हम्मा में तो कुछ चैलेंज है ही नहीं. जो भी रहे ये अपने अहम की चैलेंज हो सकती है. जितना ईगोलेस काम करेंगे इतना इतना हम अनित्य से अनंतता की तरफ जा रहे हैं.
Dhamma is much stronger than us, and all we can do is just not stand in the way of Dhamma. That's what we can do, and that's our main task. To just let Dhamma flow.
अपने भले के लिए ये गंगा अपने पास आई है. जितना पानी पिए इतना अपना भला है. बाकी तो काम चलते ही रहेगा. मेरे बने हो न हो ये काम तो चलता ही रहेगा.
हंडदानी भिक्खवे आमन्ते जीवा. And he invites him just before he passes away, the last words, that invaluable heritage, invaluable gift from him. Vai Dhamma Sankhara Apamadena Sampadetu Vai Dhamma Sankhara. All the Sankharas are anicca, anicca, anicca. Whatever arises is bound to pass away. This is the truth. This is the law. This is nature. This is Dhamma. This is the reality. Keep on realizing this reality. Dhamma is not for just 10 days. It is for the whole life. Every moment of a human being is so precious. Make use of it for your own good, for your own benefit, for your own liberation, and for the good and benefit for so many others, so many others.